Three continents, one history.
We're stitching the threads that bind the city of Birmingham with Africa and the Caribbean.
Three continents, one history.
From Africa through the Caribbean to Europe, we take you on a journey of the transatlantic slave trade.
Three continents, one history.
We reconnect the people, events, cultures, societies, and heritage of three mighty continents.
Africa, the Americas, Europe.
We invite you to engage with over 500 years of history and meet the men and women that shaped and changed the world forever.
Marcus Garvey, Nanny of the Maroons, Yah Asantewaa.
Listen to how the past creates the legacy and living histories of today. Three continents, one history on New Style Radio.
Three continents, one history.
I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me. I wish I could say all the things that I should say, say them loud, say them clear, for the whole round world to hear. I wish I could share all the love that's in my heart, remove all the bars that keep us apart.
It is a very good evening to you. Welcome to the Three Continents, One History radio show. Just listening there to the sounds of the late, great Nina Simone with that classic, classic song, To Be Free. My name is Ancobia, and with me is my co-host,
Ebony.
And we shall be taking you right up into the hour of 8 o'clock. Okay, in the studio we have esteemed lecturer and author, Robin Walker, and he's travelled from London to share some invaluable information with us this evening regarding the transatlantic slave trade, and also we'll be briefly talking about European expansion into Africa. Robin is the author of several books, his most recent works being When We Ruled. That's a book that's been talked about very much in this community at the moment and over the past several months, and it's certainly a book that we're going to put on our website as one of the resources that you, the listener, can tap into to expand your knowledge. Robin, welcome to the Three Continents radio show.
Thanks for having me.
Three continents, one history.
Okay, on to our discussion for tonight. Now, the general perception when talking about the transatlantic slave trade is that the Africans themselves are to blame for slavery.
Africa is to blame for the slave trade in one sense. We lost. And had we won, there wouldn't have been a slave trade. So in that sense, there's a lot of negligence that we can place at the door of Africans, but it's military negligence. People not stepping hard enough with the program. And essentially, if West Africa had produced a lot more people, like the great South African leader, Shaka, things would have been very, very different. But the bottom line is, we didn't. So in the truth, the negligence is, we lost. And that's the only way it can be seen. Now, Europeans will point out this or that group of people that sold out, but I defy anyone to point out a country that has been devastated continuously for 200 years and no one sell out after that period. Of course you're going to get people selling out, but you have to understand the realities of power. Once power is exerted, people will step in line, and that's just the way human beings everywhere on the planet are. But that doesn't change the culpability. And to give an example, when Moors and Arabs ruled Spain between 711 and 1492 AD, there were European wannabes called Mozarabs who wanted to basically be black. A lot of them changed their names to Islamic names. A lot of them got with the religion that the Africans and Arabs were pushing then, Islam. A lot of them built the way that we used to build and so on. But that doesn't change the fact that Spain was colonized by an alien power. And therefore, the Mozarabs can't be blamed for wanting to erase their identity. And the same is true in reverse. Once people A colonize and conquer people B, the people responsible for what goes on in people B's territory are those that did the conquering and the colonizing. And just because you're going to get people wanting to flow with the program doesn't change the fact of who's responsible.
You talk about King Afonso I of the Congo and the letter he actually wrote to the Portuguese court. And in particular, he sent more than 20 letters to King Manuel and his successor, King John III. And he actually begged them to stop the transatlantic slave trade, but on the same part, to continue the Christianization program. Why didn't he respond more aggressively and perhaps, you know, declare war on the Portuguese?
I think part of the issue is that by the time we get to the 16th century, one notices the ways that Africans conducted themselves around other groups of people, particularly Arabs and Europeans, changes. And whereas in earlier times the response would have been aggressive, and there's examples that we can point to where the Romans had to bribe the Nubians to stay out of Roman-controlled Egypt, and the Nubians took the bribes and then invaded Roman-controlled Egypt anyway. Mm-hmm. And you notice that there's that kind of way of conducting oneself which changes very, very dramatically into this kind of police kind of attitude.
Right.
And I don't know why that is. But whoever can get to the bottom of that will have a major key to understanding part of what happened during that period. Essentially, the slave trade was a series of wars that we lost. Mm-hmm. And that would then give some understanding of why we lost.
Right, so you talk of a series of wars that the Africans lost, but why did African countries actually let Europeans build slave forts in their countries?
Initially, they forced their way in. The best example being what happened on the coast of Ghana. When they arrived in 1481, the Portuguese negotiated with the local ruler, Kwame Ansah. They asked his permission to build a fort on his land, and his response, historians have recorded it for posterity, he clearly said no. The Portuguese agent, Diogo de Azambuja, continued, "My lord, the King of Portugal must have this house built on your land." Kwame Ansah appears to concede, and then when the Portuguese start to build, he attacks them, showing that his position of no was consistent, you know, based on the old notion of if people don't hear, they have to feel. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Once the Portuguese had forced their way in, it then became a matter of terrorism to keep control of the fort and keep control of the people around that fort. And that was then followed by Dutch terrorism. What happened was is that essentially Africans traded one slave master for another. The first time it was the Portuguese. Once the Dutch had beaten the Portuguese, the Dutch took the slave forts off the Portuguese and they now became Dutch forts. And the same thing, it was now Dutch terrorism. But what both the Portuguese and the Dutch did was they bribed a certain segment of the African population. And those same people who were bribed, European historians record this as examples of trade, because money passed hands. It can then look like Africans were paid rent to have those forts placed on their land, when in reality it was bribery. Certain elites were bribed off.
How did the local people respond?
There's an account by an Englishman called Towerson, and he visits Portuguese controlled what we would today call Ghana, and he visits it in the 16th century, and there's a bit where he says a young fellow told us that the Portugals, using the old English spelling, were bad men and they would make slaves of them if they could catch them, and they would put irons on their legs. Again, irons is in this funky spelling, y-r-o-i-n-s. Now notice what the young fellow didn't say. He didn't say our leaders sold us out. he said the Portuguese were responsible.
Yes.
And that's very, very clear. The same Towerson describes other situations where he visits a town ruled by a chief called Don John, which we can work out. That would have been a Portuguese name, Dom Xiao.
Okay.
And you're only going to get a Portuguese name like Dom Xiao had you been baptized a Christian. And he says that Dom Xiao was also warring with the Portuguese. And if you think about it, this would have been his Christian convert that they had converted. And even he's fighting against them, making it quite clear what the power relationships were.
It's interesting that you touch upon Christianity there, because King Alfonso himself was a Christian. But you're saying that somehow the Africans, it's almost like they thought they were equals with the Europeans, because we're Christians, you're Christians, we're now brothers, you should be treating us much better.
Indeed. And what's more, the Portuguese themselves issued a document called the Regimento. And the Regimento is basically the first plan in history for the colonization of Africa, taking African land, taking African people through slavery, and taking African minds through Christianity. But when one reads the Regimento, I've seen excerpts from it translated, the Portuguese refer to the kings of Congo as brothers. And this brotherly terminology could very easily deceive the modern reader into not seeing the sinister plot that is also laid out in that same document.
Yes. For African countries who generally resisted being sold into slavery, how did the Europeans in general, the Dutch, the French, the British, how did they begin to treat these countries?
With extreme violence. And there's several ways you can do it. One is just outright hit and run raids. This is what the Portuguese started in 1441. The problem with hit and run raids is that there's a very high chance that you could end up being killed in that process. And since Europe didn't have any real military advantage over Africa in 1441, certainly they had muskets, Africans didn't, but muskets weren't particularly accurate then.
By muskets, you mean guns?
Firearms, yeah.
Firearms, yes.
And the firearms became more accurate as they developed, and then the advantage becomes bigger and bigger. So it's hit and run raids is one way of doing it. Then people realized that hit and run raids had their problems. So another way of doing it was Europeans living on the coast and abusing African women and then producing a mixed race class on the coast. And then the mixed race class would then be the people being the middlemen in the slave trade. The Portuguese were the first people to do it, and then the Dutch followed straight after. That becomes another way of taking action.
Yes.
A third way would be to pit groups against groups. And you can do it by starting a chain reaction. Attack one group of people, or get one group of people to enslave another group of people, and then arm both sides. And then once you do that, the numbers of people captured will then just explode. Another way of doing it is to crash people's economies. For example, gold economy being crashed. Once Europeans found that they could get free gold from South America by destroying the Native Americans and just simply seizing that gold, African gold economies crash. You then leave people no other trading products except people. So there's all sorts of ways that you could make it happen. But essentially, I would relate the main methods as being very, very similar to the civil war going on in Iraq right now, where it's quite clear who's behind it. But if you look at things on a shallow level, it might appear to the uninitiated that Sunni is fighting Kurd, is fighting Shia, when in reality the British and the Americans are behind all of it.
Yes, divide and rule.
Indeed.
Okay, okay. The Portuguese, as you said earlier, they got into the slave trade in 1441.
That's right.
It would be another nearly 200 years later before the British would enter the scene.
It was a bit more recent than that. It's probably 1562.
Okay,
is the date they normally is given.
120 years after
Portuguese. Yeah, and that would be the pirate, Sir John Hawkins.
Yes. Check out the title, Sir.
Yeah, one of his ships was called Jesus of Lubeck.
Good God. So the British come in 120 years later.
Mm-hmm.
What happens What kind of state do they now find Africa in terms of, you've had the Portuguese in there, the Dutch in there. What kind of countries did they now come into? What was the effect of what the Portuguese presence in terms of what they'd actually done to the Africans?
We know what the effects were because of the writings of Towerson, who is then describing essentially what he's seeing. And he's seeing the devastation. There's one passage in his writings where he says he visited the town of John de Viso, and you could work out that's another Portuguese convert's town. And there are not passing 6 houses in it. And you may wonder, well, what happened to the rest of them? They'd all been burned. Right? Now, certainly, there were still high civilizations in West Africa at the time. There was the Benin Empire, who Europeans had to step with great correctness, because the Benin Empire, first of all, Christianity was not going anywhere in Benin. What happened was previous rulers had organized a traditional religion and put it on official footing. And once they did that, Christianity was not going to have any real impact. There was also the Congo Empire, but the Congo Empire was being destroyed from the inside by the Portuguese efforts. You also had the largest empire in West Africa, the Songhai Empire, which was still flourishing in 1562. But the British and the Arabs had worked out a plan to deal with Songhai, and in 1591 they destroyed it in an invasion led by a Spaniard called Judah Pasha. There are letters flying between Queen Elizabeth and the Moroccan, or the Arab ruler, Sultan El Mansur, where she agrees to supply him with the cannonballs, the firearms, and so forth, and Europeans who could use those weapons. And so after 1591, the Songhai Empire, which at the time had ruled 2/3 of West Africa, was no more. Therefore, 2/3 of West Africa was without government, and therefore the slave trade could explode.
So how exactly did the British manage to enter that scene and then come to dominate? Did basically all of this discord help them out in that aim?
What happened is that the Europeans, in conducting the slave trade, were not necessarily friends. What they were rivals. And what would then happen is the best armed would end up beating the previous enslavers. So at one time, the Portuguese had the upper hand. But then things start going south at home in Portugal. By the time we get to the 16th century, Portugal is less of a power. And that slide, the Portuguese have never been able to arrest that slide. It's now one of the poorest countries in Europe. Then the action then moves to Holland. In particular, there's two companies that are established, the Dutch West India Company and the Dutch East India Company. And they become major players in the mass enslavement. And then what happens is Britain then moves in and essentially takes over the scene.
Three continents, one history.
Okay, if you've just tuned in, you're listening to the Three Continents, One History show on New Star Radio 98.7 FM. In the studio, we have author Robin Walker with us this evening. In this part of the show, we're going to move on and talk about Birmingham's involvement in the transatlantic slave trade. Now, not much is known, really, about Birmingham's involvement. You've heard a lot, probably, about Liverpool, and you've heard about Bristol. But at the moment, we're the only project to take a look at all aspects of Birmingham's involvement. There's been work done on Birmingham's humanitarian contribution. So we're looking at the manufacturing and any other aspects that might come up to show Birmingham's involvement. And that's where we'll be conducting our research. We'll be looking through archives. And then hopefully as we go down the line through the project, filling in those gaps of information regarding Birmingham's involvement. Can you tell us a bit more then about the triangular trade? What was going on there? We hear this term, and tell us exactly what that would mean.
The term triangular trade refers to three journeys of the same ship. One way of looking at it, the way I look at it, is the first journey is the ship leaving from Africa to Americas. And that ship would be laden with enslaved people. As I said, mostly 13 and 14-year-olds. And then people at both top and bottom end of the age bracket, but that would be your average. And they would then set sail from Africa to either the Caribbean, to South America, or to North America. Then there's a second leg of that same ship's journey, where they would sail from the Caribbean, South America or North America, and would sail to Europe. And on that ship would be gold, which would have been dug by enslaved people in South America. Sugar, which would have been grown by enslaved people on sugar plantations. Products made from sugar or derived from sugar, such as rum. Another one would have been tobacco, which would then be another product that would be on that ship. And that ship would then sail from the Caribbean, North America or South America to Europe. And the goods would then be sold in various places. And so various companies would then come out of that. Then you have the third leg of the journey, which is the ship leaving from Europe to Africa. And that would then have cheap manufactured products, which would then be sold to enslavers in Africa. And these enslavers, some would be white, some would be mixed race, some would be black. And the whole point of the manufactured goods is to wipe out African industries. So that way you can then make the African industries dependent on the cheap imports to wipe out the handcrafted products. And that would be the third leg. Now, European scholars present the third leg as the first leg because they're starting in Europe. And therefore, the passage of enslaved people, they make the second leg, which is why they call it the middle passage, because in their reckoning, it becomes the second leg. And then for them, the third journey is from the Americas to Europe.
You've done it the other way around. Why?
Because the most important thing going on is the capture and transportation of enslaved people. It's not the second most important thing, it's the most important thing. And so it's important when we tell the history, we tell it in such a way as to bring dignity to our people.
You talk of the empire being used by the British, but who would you say were the principal players in British society that were actually involved as investors or, you know, basically running this system?
There are one or two banking firms that have a somewhat sordid history. There's a historian called Eric Williams, who's also Prime Minister at one time of Trinidad, and he wrote a book called Capitalism and Slavery, where he points out that there were banking families of Gurney and Freem and two enslavers from Jamaica, two Quaker enslavers, David and Alexander Barclay, married into that banking family. And as they say, the rest is history. Incidentally, that same bank had a very distasteful history concerning apartheid in South Africa. Whereas I remember in my university student days, the various banks mostly kept their distance from South Africa. Barclays Bank did not keep its distance, and showing that sordid history is a long one. Various other companies as well, the most obvious one being Lloyd's Insurance, Lloyd's of London, which was responsible for insuring the slave ships against damage and that kind of thing. So there are many industries that you can point to. And then, of course, you end up with the irony that many black people coming here in the 1950s, one of the places that they used to work was the tea houses. And that's quite an ironic history, if we know the history of tea and, more importantly, sugar.
So how did cities like Birmingham become so important, and what did the transatlantic slave trade mean to its development and perhaps the prosperity as a city?
I read a very disturbing document concerning the Ashanti Empire. The Ashanti Empire was an empire that was founded approximately the year 1700 in what is today Ghana. And it was founded after 200 and so years of the Ghanaians, if you like, losing the war. So here we get an empire on a sellout program, essentially. Now, this empire, I understand, was armed with muskets made in Birmingham.
Right.
And so we then get, you know, a rather disturbing link that essentially the Ashanti Empire, its firearms, was coming from here. Birmingham.
Right.
And the Ashanti Empire had a very strong relationship, a 100-year relationship, in fact, with the British Empire. The story is often painted as one of an equal partnership between the Ashantis and the British. Is that true?
I think a lot of modern Ashantis would like to paint it that way, but the truth of the matter is they were used. And the evidence that they were used is that the moment the British had no need for them anymore, the British destroyed them and then seized their land, where it then became the Gold Coast, and then a different part of their empire was seized and then became the Ivory Coast, or Côte d'Ivoire. So what you then get was the British then seized one bit of it, the French seized another bit. So essentially, when one looks at the bigger picture, the Ashanti Empire was used.
I just want to go back to Birmingham just slightly. In terms of its development as a city, if you have principal parts of the country like Birmingham selling guns, how prosperous is that for the city? Can they now begin to really develop and come on the scene, so to speak, as it were, on par with cities like Bristol and Liverpool, Manchester?
I don't have the evidence for whether it was comparable to these other places or not. Looking at Birmingham, I suspect probably not, only because the grandeur of Liverpool, for example, I don't see it in Birmingham. Now, in the case of Liverpool, I have visited the Maritime Museum, and what there are a series of paintings of the city of Liverpool as it was in the year 1700, as it was in the year 1800, as it was in the year 1900. And what's interesting is that the paintings from 1700 show that there was no city of Liverpool. What it was a castle and castle walls. That was it. There was no city. By the time we get to the year 1800, the grandeur that exists right now, the four-story houses, where you've got just rows of them alongside the Mersey, that's when they came up, and you can see that in the paintings. But I don't have that specific information for Birmingham.
I suspect that some of the wealth coming from the slave trade at the time was going to particular individuals rather than benefiting the entire population.
It would benefit the population as well, just not directly. It would then be indirectly. In other words, no one can say that, you know, they were unaffected, because obviously that's where the nation's wealth would be coming from.
Okay, and you have people being employed to make the guns and to be involved.
Indeed.
Make the shackles, the fetters.
Yeah, and if you look at England's role as an arms dealer, it's not just the biggest role today. It goes all the way back to the time when Queen Elizabeth was writing to Sultan El Mansur.
And that's Queen Elizabeth the First.
Indeed. So once we know that, yeah, Britain has never lost its position amongst the leading arms dealers of the world.
You actually alluded to manufactured goods. With Birmingham being sort of an industrial city, how much do you think they would have had an involvement in perhaps producing those goods, these cheap goods, that were then, you know, bought over to Africa and exchanged?
Unfortunately, I don't have that evidence for Birmingham. I have it for other places.
Right.
For example, we know for a fact Manchester's cotton was used to undermine West African cotton products.
Okay.
And many authors have commented on that, because West African cloth from particularly Yoruba land was of a particularly high quality and much, much higher than what you could get in Manchester. But that became the centre of textiles. Birmingham, unfortunately, I don't have that evidence.
It's quite strange, actually, because if you look at Manchester today and its relationship with Ghana, still today, in 2007, from what I understand, you have cloth from Ghana being made in Manchester and then sent over to Ghana.
Isn't that ironic?
Yeah, so when we get all of this fine cloth from Ghana and say, oh, look, I've got indigenous clothing,
mm-hmm.
It's not true. It actually comes from Manchester.
And you can tell the indigenous stuff, because when we read the descriptions of what they used to use, silks. In other words, the kentes used to be made of silk. They're not made of silk today. So you can see whether or not standards have gone up or gone down.
Well, Three Continents, One History on New Star Radio.
Let's go back to Africa. You have Africans being captured and taken to dungeons.
Mm-hmm.
What happened once they got to those dungeons?
In truth, this is an area that I've never really researched, because it's just simply too grim. If you try reading some of the primary source documents, one of my friends tried, and as he put it, all he wanted to do was vomit. More recently, the former BBC news presenter Maurice Stewart did a documentary where somebody mentioned being waist deep in feces. inside the Elmina dungeon. And that paints something of a picture. Yes. Not the kind of picture that people would really want to delve too deeply into, but it does paint a picture.
Many of us, including ourselves, myself and Ebony, many of us have never been to a dungeon in Africa. Many of us have never seen the films in which they show you what it was like for Africans in those dungeons. What we're going to do right now is let you listen, all right, to what it was like for some Africans in those dungeons. This clip is taken from the film Sankofa.
Listen to how the past creates the legacy and living histories of today. Three continents, one history on New Star Radio.
Listen to the sounds as the woman is screaming for help. Listen to the sounds as she's actually branded, that is marked as, "You're my property." Listen to this. It's horrifying, isn't it? Very, very horrifying.
That was pretty distressing, wasn't it?
Yeah, very, very distressing. And it's one of those things, as Robin was just saying, not, you know, he hasn't done the research on it. A lot of us don't like to know about that aspect of the transatlantic slave trade story. But, you know, we just wanted to give you an insight into what Africans experienced. It kind of goes through you to think, my God, exactly, you know, imagine that's just one voice. Mm-hmm. You can imagine the thousands and thousands of people who were inside of those dungeons.
Yeah.
And as Robin has just said, some people up to their waist in feces, vomit, and there's blood around them. That was just one voice. Multiply that by thousands of voices.
That's just a few seconds. Some people were there for nearly a year.
Yeah. If you can, get hold of that film.
Yeah. It is just a film, but it does create such a picture when you watch it.
Yeah. Sankofa is the film to get. No Hollywood stuff, the real stuff. Okay, we continue with our discussion tonight.
Okay.
Are you aware of what the journey going across the Atlantic would have been like for the Africans?
Same thing. There's an account by Oluda Equiano, where he described it as being like a slaughterhouse. You know, slaughterhouse, we're cutting up animals, and basically you've got blood and mucus everywhere. And if you're chained to somebody, what people forget, of course, is that on ships carrying enslaved people, the average age of the Africans on those ships would have been somewhere between the ages of 13 and 14. So essentially you've got children chained together in areas that are between 1.5 feet and 3 feet 3 inches high. So in other words, no one can stand up in it. So essentially you're chained together in what's essentially like a coffin, and you've got people above you vomiting on you. You've got mucus everywhere, blood everywhere. You're chained to a dead person. You could be chained to somebody giving birth, all sorts of horrors. And if that's something that you're doing for, some people say, 52 days, you could see that that's not an experience one would want to,
Do we have any accounts, even from crew members or maybe even enslaved Africans, about the conditions they were kept? I mean, you said yourself...
Oluda Equiano. And he's not the only one, but he's the one that, because his writings have a certain sanction... And the description comparing it to a slaughterhouse, that was his.
If you've only just tuned in, you're listening to the Three Continents One History Show on New Star Radio 98.7 FM. We just talked about the fact that there were, banks, insurers, all that sort of thing. Insurance would imply the slave trade was actually, you know, a risky business. Why is it then that they would go across, you know, facing a risky journey, perhaps boats not making it there, Africans resisting there again, you could lose lives again? What was the profit margin, if you want to put it like that, for the Europeans? What made it worth it? Do you have any idea?
I don't, but I know who does. Professor Eric Williams has got that information. Now, one thing we do know about mass enslavement is that the concept of the millionaire, outside of certain African contexts, such as the Empire of Mali and so forth, didn't really exist for ordinary people. Back in the day, if someone was a millionaire, that meant simply that they were part of the royal family.
Right.
Now, if you can be a millionaire as a businessman. And that concept of millionaires springing up out of nowhere. And so an ordinary person, an ordinary working class white person, could actually make it big for the first time in history.
Okay.
And that's really what that was. If they were prepared to take those risks and arm themselves to the teeth to protect themselves, they could actually make some very, very big money.
Were they actually selective in some ways about the people that they actually took across the Atlantic? I mean, you say, for example, the average age was 14. Were they picking out mainly males, you know, mainly females? Explain a bit more about that.
The records say that it was about two-thirds, one-third male-female.
Okay.
But then you also have the contraband slaves. The contraband ones were the ones that don't appear in the records, and those were almost always female. So what the actual ratios were, don't know, because once you know that it's biased in one favour in the records and then your contraband ones are female, don't know what the actual ratios are.
You're saying there that it was two-thirds male and then you had this sort of like component of contrabands. Was that the best idea for them to be taking so many males, especially in relation to the amount of Europeans who would have had to man the ship? They would have been outnumbered.
Yeah, the story of resistance, first of all, you have those people resisting being captured in the first place. Then you have those resisting being frog marched from where they were captured to the slave dungeons. Then you've got those committing suicide in the dungeons. Then you have those committing suicides before they got onto the ships. Then you have those committing suicide on ships. And you've got various slave rebellions. The most famous one of them all being the revolt on the Amistad, 1839. But there were others too. And you also have revolts where a ship is leaving and not the enslaved Africans storm the ship, other Africans will storm the ship. And there are evidences of that too. But certainly what the crews would have, I mean, they'd all be armed to the teeth, knives, muskets, cutlasses and so forth. And certainly there was a major security issue, especially if they had to move enslaved people from below deck to above deck. And they did do that so that if people are lying prostrate for weeks on end, their muscles weaken. So they had this idea of getting them on ship to dance. And if people were on board for any length of time, that becomes a security risk, where if anything was going to kick off, that would be the time. So obviously the crews were heavily, heavily armed.
So you now have Africans being taken. Africans have been kidnapped. They've been held at forts, castles. They've made that voyage across the Atlantic. What happens to them once they arrive in the Americas, in the Caribbean?
There's a process called seasoning, where it's one of those processes where the least said the better. Essentially, a regime was set up where essentially the weakest were going to die, and therefore those that could withstand the torture of that. And then it would then be people being split up and sold and all the rest of it. And then the plantation life would then be divided in such ways as to keep the people divided. So you'd end up with some people working on fields, some people working in yards, some people working in the houses, and so you would then end up with different, if you like, class of slave. Then you've got some who are metallurgists, who would then have a different status to everybody else. So the smiths would have a different status to everybody else. Those who are musicians would have a different status to everybody else, and so on and so forth. In other words, a whole set of practices to keep people divided.
There's a theme of resistance running on there, but were there any further forms of resistance shown? Like, for example, you said many people committed suicide. What was happening in the Caribbean and the Americas?
The most powerful examples of resistance were those Africans that ran away and set up their own governments. And in 1595, right up until 1694, 99 years, there was an all-African state in Brazil called the Republic do Palmares. And that state is a major, major achievement in African history, because here you have a state that's multi-ethnic. It has to be remembered, Africans from Africa would have been everything from Moors to Zulus, right? Mm. Speaking however many different languages.
Yes.
And now, once you've got them all under one program and hanging together for 99 years, throwing back invasions from the Portuguese and from the Dutch being waged every 1.5 years, was the amount of invasions. That's an incredible achievement. You also have Maroon governments. There's one in Colombia, which the Spanish signed a treaty with in 1599. You had one in Suriname stroke Guyana, where the Maroons there were remained independent throughout their history, and they've only been reintegrated into the modern countries in the 20th century. Mm-hmm. You had Maroon communities in Jamaica, where 1,500 Maroons revolted in 1655, and they remained an independent people. Now, they weren't necessarily dealing with cents,
yes,
but they remained an independent state within a state right up until the 20th century. And it's only in the 20th century that there's been any moves to integrate the Maroons into the body of Jamaican society.
Now, you say they weren't dealing with any sense. I think you're referring to the fact that they actually went into agreement with the British government that they could retain their independence if they captured fellow Africans and handed them over to the British to be re-enslaved.
And would you believe that Captain Kwaku signed his name to that nonsense in 1739? Mm. So after 1739, the Maroons become something of an embarrassment. But the fact being, they did have an all-black state.
Okay, that is the Maroons in Jamaica.
In Jamaica,
yes,
yeah.
Yes.
You also have Maroon communities in the United States, various states like Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and so on. Hardly ever spoken about. And then you also have in America nations that are mixtures of African and Native American, the most obvious being the Seminole Indians. Now, sad to report, there is foolishness kicking off now, where the Native Americans are trying to kick the blacks out of their nations. And yes, that's going on right now. Google some of these stories. The Africans are called freemen in the literature.
Yes.
Where they've tried to revoke the Indian citizenship of the freemen. But despite, you know, 21st century foolishness, there is actually a proud history where, as I said, one of the Native American states, nations, was in fact a half-black nation.
I'm sure Bob Marley makes reference to them in his song Buffalo Soldiers.
He that's
talks
right
about the relationship between the Africans and the Native
that's right, that's
American
right
Indians.
Yeah, yeah. And the only point I need to make here is that notice that we didn't see any of this where, you know, the Sunday films where you used to see Ronald Reagan and John Wayne wiping out the Native Americans.
Yes.
Some of those people they would have been fighting would have been us.
Yes.
But we weren't shown that.
Okay.
And similarly as well, cowboys, one third of them were either us or Mexicans.
Okay, now that's very new.
Wow. Well, there it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But again, we weren't necessarily told that.
You know, I always thought cowboys never existed. I just thought it was something that they made up.
In a sense, they did make it up, if you think about it. But the truth is that one third of them were us and Mexicans.
Three continents, one history.
If you've just tuned in, you're listening to the Three Continents, One History radio show. This evening we've got the esteemed lecturer and author, Robin Walker, in the studio, and we've been talking about the actual triangular trade as regard to the transatlantic slave trade. We've been talking about Africa's involvement, the effect upon Africa of the transatlantic slave trade, and some of the actual resistances that took place, and that's in Africa, on the way over to the Americas and the Caribbean, and actually on the plantations themselves. Let's continue. What's the effect of the transatlantic slave trade and, after that, colonization on African politics, culture, and their economic development up to the present day? How's that worked out for Africa?
It's fair to say that most of Africa has not recovered. And the devastation has been so strong that African indigenous industries, there's a break, there's no continuity between how things used to be and how things are now. African urban life, there's a break. few people live in the ancient cities that they used to live in. There's a total break from that to modern living. Massive amounts have been lost. Places where there used to be universities, you've now got massive amounts of illiteracy and foolishness, where there used to be a scholarly culture, and there is no link between the universities today, established by the Europeans, and the ones that we had. And so essentially, it's a bit like a people losing their historical memory. And then once they've lost their historical memory, that break between the present and the past is massive. Now, what it means for modern African politics is that modern African states today, their link to their past is tenuous in every single case, because they've not really been able to make that history work for them for a whole bunch of reasons. Most African countries don't have a national language, and the reason why not is because during mass enslavement, you would have people migrating here and there to flee slave traders, and hundreds of new languages developing, new dialects developing, once people live in more and more fragmented communities. So if you were to go to modern Nigeria, there is no language called Nigerian. And so the national culture doesn't exist. And once you have that, you have people who have no loyalty to their nation. They only have loyalty to the fragmented groups that came about after mass enslavement. And that results then in modern African politics not being about voting for who's going to be the best person to lead the nation, but being about who belongs to your ethnic group that you can trust. And the result is then a recipe for foolishness, incidentally. Rather more than that, the economic bases that used to exist in Africa don't anymore. Once you've lost a trade route, you've lost it forever. You can't get that back. Once you've lost manufacturing processes, you've lost that forever. Rather than building on the past becomes totally disconnected for you, unable to build upon. Once a people's psychology has been affected by alien or semi-alien religions, particularly Islam and Christianity, essentially, you've lost the plot. And the kind of cultural renewal that would enable people to bring their history and culture back and make it live and use it to build national cultures and ultimately a Pan-African attitude, Africa is so far away from that.
Does this also relate to the Caribbean? Because I've heard people, last week we had Dr. Clive Harris on this show, and he was talking about the need for a Pan-Caribbean mentality to come about on the scene. You're talking about a Pan-African worldview. Would that worldview also incorporate the Caribbean nations and those of us living in Britain and throughout Europe today?
That depends on how progressive people are in their thinking. The Caribbean does have its problems, does have its foolishness, but tribalism isn't one of them. Yes. Because, for example, in Jamaica, everyone speaks some form of, in the biggest of inverted commas, English. Now, notice I've used the biggest inverted commas, but you don't have people having divided loyalties on that question. Now, certainly, you bring Trinidadians up, Jamaicans will come with foolishness. That's a problem, but once you have it at least within the boundaries of a country, you can build a nationhood. But in African countries, they haven't even got that because of the divisions based on tribe caused by mass enslavement.
You've talked in a sense there about the weakening of Africa, but how was Europe then strengthened by its involvement in the transatlantic slave trade in Africans?
Professor John Henry Clark says what Europe did was it solved its problems by fighting other peoples. You could export peoples that you don't particularly want here, but the bottom line is they're there, you've got a link with them, and they've got a common enemy, the blacks. And you'll see lots of examples of this. Haki Madhubuti gave the example of, in Europe during World War II, you had various Christian Europeans going after their Jewish brothers and sisters. And when the Nationalist Party in South Africa was setting up apartheid, you had Christians and Jews coming together to decide, what are we going to do about those blacks? And that's an example of how you can solve your problems at our expense. And that's essentially what Europe has done.
You've touched upon religion a lot throughout this discussion. Why is it hard for those, for black people who were Christians or Muslims, to understand the transatlantic slave trade and the role of their respective religions in that trade?
This is the problem. Because most black people who are religious, their religion is the most important thing in their life. They rate it higher than their ethnic identity. And therefore, nothing bad is going to be said about Christianity. Nothing bad is going to be said about Islam. The fact that both religions were used to enslave your ancestors and to destroy your mentalities in the present, you know, many people don't really want to get with that. And the bottom line is we have to face the truth. And facing the truth means we have to confront big people issues. We can't continue to live as children. And if it means that exposing your religion in the role of your enslavement and destruction, that has to be done. Black people that have names like Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Peter, Paul, those names are African names. Black people have names like Abdullah, Muhammad, Idris. Those are not African names. Those are names that your ancestors, once they'd been beaten, once they'd lost the argument, once they'd been conquered, those names were then forced on us. And the truth of the matter is that you can't be equal with a European unless you deal with that issue, because you're carrying his name. You can't be equal with an Arab unless you're dealing with that issue, because you're carrying his name. He's not carrying your name, you're carrying his.
Yes, and you're speaking his language.
Yes, absolutely.
And wearing his clothes,
bowing down to his gods, and that's the bottom line. And the truth of the matter is that we as a people aren't going anywhere unless we deal with that and deal with it honestly.
Okay. What has been the legacy of the transatlantic slave trade on African descendants today? Those of us living in Britain, France, Amsterdam, America, Jamaica, Barbados, Grenada, Brazil?
The main legacies is that our behavior, which is our thought and our practice, has been changed. Our attitudes to work show evidence of being enslaved. Our attitude to play shows evidence of being enslaved. Our attitudes to beauty shows evidence that we've been enslaved. Our attitudes to property shows evidence that we've been enslaved. Our attitudes towards each other shows evidence that we've been enslaved. Then you have the legacies in Africa, where a lot of African scholars have not highlighted the damage that mass enslavement has done to Africa, which is why 500 years ago, Africans were equals on the economic stage, on the political stage, on the cultural stage. 500 years later, it's at the bottom and sliding fast. And the tribalism that mass enslavement has caused, most Africans haven't acknowledged that. So you end up with a situation that there's a legacy, but no one's acknowledged the legacy, but it's destroying you anyway. And these are the sorts of things that mass enslavement has done for us as a people.
Now, in your book, When We Ruled, you actually talk about the period of the transatlantic slave trade, if I'm correct, as not really being a part of black history.
Correct.
You talk more about the maroon societies like the Palmeiras that you mentioned earlier in Brazil as examples of what could be cited as black history in this period. Why do you make that distinction?
History is the record and process of a people engaged in struggle to shape the world in their interests and images. And once we know that that's what it is, during mass enslavement, most enslaved people weren't shaping anything. They were being shaped by alien powers to do things that alien powers wanted. Black nations on a sellout program were not acting in anything that you could call a pro-black program. They were being shaped by alien powers to do negative things to black people. So that's not black history. Our history is what did we do for ourselves.
Okay.
And it has to be a collective history of achievement. So it's not just individuals, you know, pointing out that, sake of argument, Queen Elizabeth I knew a black woman called Lucy Negro. That's not black history, because that's not collective achievement. It has to be group achievement. And so the group achievements have to be the 250 armed revolts that took place in the United States by enslaved Africans, the setting up of black states in Brazil, Colombia, Guyana stroke Suriname, Jamaica, the glorious Haitian Revolution, where black people freed themselves from mass enslavement, the struggles of black people alongside other ethnic groups that take place in the United States to kick butt. This is the substance of our history.
Right, we're coming towards the end of the programme now, so we'll just wrap up with the interview here. But I must first thank you very much, Robin Walker, for coming into the studio this evening.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you.
For those of you who've just tuned in, you've been attuned to the Three Continents, One History show here at New Star Radio 98.7 FM. We've been speaking, myself and Kobe and Ebony, with esteemed author and lecturer Robin Walker. For more information about Robin Walker, be sure to check out his website www.whenweruled.com, and also you can check out his book When We Ruled, which is available at local bookstores in the community. Thank you once again, Robin.
Thank you.
Okay, Ebony, we've come to the end of another show.
That's number three done now, isn't it?
Yes, number three. Show number three. Next week, we're talking about life on the
plantations from sunup till sundown. So we'll see you then. We're on from 7 until 8 next week, Tuesday.
Okay. Good night, folks.
Good night.
Join the Three Continents, One History radio show, only available on New Star Radio, every Tuesday from 7 till 8 p.m.
I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me. I wish I could say all the things that I should say.
New Star Radio, 98.7 FM, Birmingham's number one community FM.